Welcome to the last section on our food safety topic, and this section is going to be covering organic foods and GMOs. We're going to first start with organic and what the regulations are in order to be organic. So what does that mean when you see organic on a label? Now for crop products, there can be no synthetic pesticides or fertilizers. No sewer sludge. I know that sounds nasty, but don't think that that is not being used in on your conventional crops. Remember we talked about water contamination and that recycled, reused water. It may not, you know, the sludge probably doesn't draw to mind any pretty thoughts, but it's not as bad as that. But that can be used on some conventional crops, but not on organic crops. No irradiation and no genetically modified organisms, or GMOs. Now for meat, they have to meet the health and welfare standards for the animals. So the animals have to be treated well, no antibiotics, no hormones. The feed has to be organic as well. So you can't have an organic beef if they're feeding it GMO corn. And have to have access to the outdoors. That's a lot of the problem with the feedlots. More at the feedlots, but say the chickens are kept inside or they're cooped inside. Same with sometimes for some of the other animals or the pigs. Usually they're in these big feedlots. The cattle, they're lined up right next to each other, so there's not a lot of room to move. So this access to the outdoors is important. I do want to say that just because there is access to the outdoors, that doesn't necessarily mean the animals go outdoors. So that's a little bit of a catch right there. Now, usually with our organic food, there's no use of pesticides. And really, what is a pesticide? Well, it's something that controls insects and weeds and diseases. And you can have natural pesticides or herbicides. They don't have to be synthetic or artificial. And those natural pesticides can be used in organic foods. But about 400 billion pounds of pesticides are used per year. And a number of them are linked with birth defects and tumors in animals. But all of the current pesticides used have been cleared by the FDA for acceptability to be in our food source because they come in such small amounts. Again, as with anything, it's hard to really link that one pesticide to a disease, and most of the studies really have to come from animals. One of the problems with pesticides is that a lot of people state that they don't think it's effective. At the use of pesticides because the plants can become, insects become resistant to these pesticides and more powerful ones have to be developed. So you're just chasing pesticide after pesticide. And that the artificial pesticides aren't necessarily cost effective in the long run. It's more of a short-term effect. So the pros of organics. Now there are pros and cons to everything. And the pros of organic foods are that it minimizes pesticide exposure and it limits pesticide resistance. So that resistance that these bugs will build up to a pesticide and now we have to make a stronger one. The same thing with antibiotics. The use of antibiotics in animals has brought up some resistance. Those microorganisms become resistant to the antibiotics because they're used so much. So then we have to find a more powerful antibiotic or a different antibiotic, and in some cases within people, when treating people with certain infections, it's very difficult if they're resistant to, those bugs are resistant to the antibiotics. It can get a little bit scary. Again, it's going to benefit the environment. The organic standards do help to overall benefit the environment. The cons, 25 to 30% of organic produce has pesticides when it's been tested, and this is generally in the major grocery store chains. If you're buying from a local CSA or a local farmer at your farmer's market, you're not going to have the 25 to 30% contamination. So it's generally more with the larger producers. But when you go into the store, a big grocery store, it might not be worth it as much to have spend your money on organic if you're going to have a greater chance of getting pesticides anyway. I do want to say that within that 30%, there's still less pesticides. There's, I think the cost is probably one of the biggest, most prohibitive aspects of buying organic. Organic is expensive, and sometimes you can get deals. Sometimes if you can buy from the CSA, you might have an advantage there, but it's expensive. A lot of people just can't afford it. And research has actually shown that it's not nutritionally superior. Now, there's a little caveat on this. I want to talk about this. But first, let's just look at one of the big articles that came out in 2012 in the Annals of Internal Medicine that actually studied. They actually went through and found 17 human studies and over 200 studies of nutrients and contaminant levels in foods. And then they only had about 3 studies that actually had clinical outcomes. So it was actually fairly in-depth research. And then they looked for in humans for, you know, what the clinical outcomes were. Do people develop more eczema or wheezing or atopic sensitization? So they're having more allergic reactions. But they didn't find any significant, they looked at pesticide levels in the urine and in the serum and the breast milk. And didn't really find any significant difference between people who are eating conventional and organic. But one of the keys is I really want to point out with this study, even though it was a big study, and it found that the micronutrients, so vitamins and minerals, are about the same between organic and conventional, is that a lot of the organic farmers, or the bigger organic farmers, aren't practicing what's called crop rotation. And when you don't do that, you're just planting one, you know, big farm of, say, wheat, or one big farm of corn. Now you're going to have nutrient depletion in the soil, and that's one of the ways that the plants get their nutrients. So if you have a nutrient depleted soil, you're going to have nutrient depleted fruits and vegetables as well, or crops. In addition, the study didn't look at all at phytonutrients, and there have been smaller studies that does show that there are definitely more phytonutrients in organic, especially, you know, smaller local farms who, especially particularly those with the crop rotation, you're gonna have more phytonutrients in those organic foods. But I do think the verdict is still out on that. Okay, so their conclusion, the published literature lacks strong evidence that organic foods are significantly more nutritious. Consumption of organic foods may reduce exposure to pesticide residues and antibiotic-resistant bacteria. So that was their conclusion. And what I'm saying is that we really haven't looked at any long-term health benefits. So what happens for people who eat organic foods for 20 years? You know, what do they have? A lower incidence of heart disease or lower incidence of cancer? You know, we don't know. That's kind of this big unknown right now. And also the phytochemicals or phytonutrients were not examined. So this is, as we go into our GMO foods, I took this in Guatemala, and this is a mural on a wall. You can see that it actually goes around the corner right here, and the Guatemalan people they consider themselves the people of the corn. So they have this very, very close tie with corn. A lot of the corn now that's grown in Guatemala is GMO, and this picture depicts how they feel about GMO corn, because they're basically saying that if you have the GMO corn, you're going to have pest-resistant crops, and if you eat it, the skeleton here is an example of what will happen to you. So we're going to talk about GMOs in just a minute. I'm going to have a slight divergent and talk a little bit about sustainability, and I want to talk a little bit about a story from Dan Barber. He is author of The Third Plate, and he has a TED Talk that's called How I Fell in Love with the Fish, which I recommend watching. But he's a proponent of small farms, of rotating crops, avoiding soil depletion, and really this demand for, he's a chef, of chefs actually demanding that we have higher quality food. And he really wants to bring back a lot of heirloom varieties, breed for flavor, breed for nutrients, as far as our crops. So it's been interesting. He's one of the leaders in the farm-to-table movement. But I want to talk a little bit about this fish, because this story that he told, one, it is a little bit funny, but at the same time, it says where our food production has gone. And he said that as a chef, there one of the challenges is trying to keep fish on the menu. A lot of people have not, like, we've overfished our seas and we don't have any fish left, so we're having to resort to farmed fish. And the same problems with feedlot beef, or if you have the chicken coops and everyone, all the animals are cramped together and they're in their own feces. It's almost the same with the farmed fish. You're having that same problem with farmed fish. So he was trying to find sustainable farmed fish, which those words don't go together, but he found one. And he was working with them and bringing it to his restaurant. And they asked him to give a talk for their farm in promotion of their sustainable farm. So he said, "Sure, I can absolutely do that." And he just wanted to do his research. So he called up and said, "Well, I just want to know, what are your fish actually being fed?" And no one seemed to know. And he had to call around and call around. And he finally got in touch with the head biologist. And the biologist, named some algae and this and that, and then said a sustainable protein. Wow, that sounds great. So he went to bed and he thought, well, what in the world is a sustainable protein? He calls him back up and he goes, oh, the sustainable protein, it's a chicken pellet. And that means, it's the feathers and, some of the bone meal put together. And he thought, well, what percent of the fish feed is going to be chicken pellets? Thinking it might be, 2%, 3%. And he said, well, it's 30%. But of course, he was like, well, what? It's sustainable about feeding chicken to fish. So we're feeding chicken to fish in a fish farm, 30%. And this is the sustainable fish farm. Now, of course, Dan Barber, what he says at the end is that he actually could never eat that fish again in particular because he thought it tasted like chicken. But I want you to think about how our food system has gone to these abnormal ways of feeding the animals. Remember we talked about at the beginning of class that, your vegetarian chicken, you're getting eggs from vegetarian chicken, and chicken are not vegetarians. Chicken are supposed to peck and eat insects and bugs and seeds, but instead they get fed GMO soy or corn. So we're feeding GMO, soy products to chicken, and so they're vegetarian chicken, which is not normal. We're feeding chicken to fish, which can you imagine any fish ever eating chicken? That just doesn't make any sense. We're feeding corn to cows, which aren't designed to eat corn at all, and some grains to cows. We're getting both GMO grain to cows. They're designed to eat grass. So what is this doing to the food we're eating? It's hard to know how that impacts our health. It's hard to make those connections and follow someone, 200,000 people for 30 years. It's going to be a long time to really know exactly, but if you just think about those processes, it might help you make some better decisions. So getting now into GMOs or genetically modified organisms. Let's first talk about the natural crossbreeding technique. And there's been crossbreeding for years. And what you do is you take two varieties that you like and you cross them. You're looking for this desired trait. And so you cross these two breeds and you get your new variety and then the desired gene comes out. But you can see there's still a mix of those two plants. And that happens naturally on some level, but when you actually do the crossbreeding, when man does it, we accelerate it. Well, when you look into our DNA technology, when we look into how we create the GMOs, now it's this mass acceleration, and it's so pinpoint. It's very, very perfect in their design that they can just take this one desired gene and then take their commercial variety and then put that trait in there. One, the big example is the gene that causes tomatoes to rot. And if you can, eliminate that and take that out, that trait out, then you end up with a tomato that's going to have a longer shelf life. So you don't have tomatoes that rot as quickly. So voila, that's an entry to the magic of GMO products. As with everything, there's always pros and cons, always positives and negatives. And when we look back to the Green Revolution when really looked into these designer crops and some of the early GMO products, the Green Revolution was able to take an area in Asia, a large area in Asia, and look at where they had dwindling farmland and food shortages, and allow them to grow a crop that could survive these droughts. And it's said to save something like 1 billion lives. I mean, it's hard to argue with 1 billion lives saved when you look at technology like this. Medicine shortages. Now they're putting beta carotene into rice to help with problems with vision in third world countries. So these are amazing feats of science, absolutely amazing. And I don't think we can't consider that. So here's the problem. Now, some of these crops, the insects end up becoming resistant. So now, of course, we need more pesticides, or we have to develop, a different breed. You can't confine them because there's cross-pollination. A little bit of the seed, pops up, and then it pollinates an organic farm or a non-GMO farm. And if you know anything about the big producer of GMOs, Monsanto, they actually go after people who are growing their GMO products because they patent their seeds. And if there's any cross-pollination into a an organic farm or a non-Monsanto farm, even if it's not organic, and their seeds come in their farm, they've gone after these small farmers and sued them for growing their crops, even though it was unintentional. And the courts have supported them. And so it's just a huge cost to farmers. And you have to rebuy seeds every year. You used to be able to not have to rebuy seeds. You use seeds from the year before and you replant the seeds. And now every year you have to rebuy seeds. So very high cost to farmers. I think one of the big things that so people are going to argue pros and cons to GMOs is that we do have a really big unknown. And we don't know the impact of GMOs on the environment or on our health. And that's what puts it for me into this con category. We really need to study the GMOs. And we look at our products out there. If you go in the grocery store, there's a huge amount of products in there that are GMO. 90% of the corn and soy that is grown is GMO, and it's going to feed the cattle and the chicken, and then we're eating those products, those foods. And most of your processed products are GMO. And I think one of the problems is that, we just don't know. In California, we actually shot down Prop 37 to not label GMO products. And it could be that there's a lot of worry for nothing, that maybe we study the GMOs, its impact on health, and there's nothing to worry about. But if we don't study it, how do we know? If we don't label the food, how do we know what we're eating? So we have Vermont recently passed a law where they're going to be labeling. You already have Maine and Connecticut. So you do have some states which are heading towards, I think it's 2016, where they're going to be introducing labeling. So I think hopefully it'll come down the road and at least we'll know which products are GMO. Well, manufacturers are very much against this because it's probably going to be everything in the supermarket is going to be GMO. Most of your processed food is. And that is a little bit scary because there is that unknown out there that we don't know the impact of GMOs on our health. And that's the end of this section on food safety.